Thank you, Sabine. Well, I think that many people here do not know what is the transverse field detector. The TFD is a filterless CMOS pixel with a peculiar characteristics of having a tunable color space. So I will be pleased to go through and review the basic working principle of the TFD during the first part of this presentation, focusing on the concept of tunable spectral responses. Then we will have a look on some experimental characterization that we did on test devices, on TFD test devices. Then I will give you some ideas, some spots about the features that can be enabled by a tunable sensors, focusing on what we propose here for the first time, which is high color accuracy acquisition mode. Well, you surely know that almost every detector used in standard CMOS pixel using color filter arrays collects carrier in a vertical direction. I mean, there's a reversely biased junctions, photocarriers are generated and then driven upward to the reversely biased junction. Well, the TFD relies on a different principle, on the creation of transverse electric fields. You can see this is the result of a simulation. I will show you later the cross-section in terms of doping profiles for this device. But just imagine then these electric field stream lines represented in red, green, and blue represent the carrier collection trajectories. Well, for light impinging in the central region, you exploit the dependence of the silicon absorption coefficient from the wavelength, and you have separation of carriers as a function of the wavelength. This is what we call a symmetric TFD configuration, and in this configuration you have that the central contact number 0 collects carrier mostly from the blue region. This is, I forgot to mention, this is a silicon surface and this is a cross-section of the device. And this is a simulation corresponding to a 90 nanometer CMOS technology, and this device was effectively realized and tested. And we can do some changes around this principle. For instance, designing a non-symmetric TFD configuration, we have no longer a symmetric structure, and we can also design, for instance, four-channel devices, so the principle is almost the same. So we exploit the dependence of the silicon absorption coefficient from the wavelength and take advantage from that, and we realize sensors for which each contact has a different spectral response because it collects carrier up to a different maximum depth. And you can imagine that lighting the sensor on the whole area or only on the central area has a great impact on the shape of the different spectral responses. Anyway, the spectral responses are different among different contacts. And how can be this realized in a CMOS technology? Well, it's not so complicated, even if it requires some care. We have to design different collecting, biasing and collecting electrodes, but we can exploit simply surface implants or surface deep implants with no need of barrier layer. This turns out in a large depletion region, and so in a large collection region in a high quantum yield. And the transfer effect is simply obtained by biasing at different voltages, the contacts number 0, number 1, and number 2. Namely, you have to bias number 2 at a larger voltage with respect to number 1, which is at a larger voltage with respect to number 0. These cross-sections correspond to the devices shown in the previous slide. And the care has to be taken in the design of the device because designing N plus implants biased at different voltages gives some difficulties in terms of punch-through current that can flow between these contacts. So a care has to be taken in designing some isolating structures constituted by P plus implants and, for instance, shallow trenches, which are common for many CMOS technologies. So which are the advantages? Clearly a high quantum yield because we have no physical filter on top of the device, and as I said, we have a large collection region without barrier layers, and no need for demosaicing as each pixel site is itself color sensitive. Well, these advantages are common, for instance, to other previously proposed sensor based on layered junctions, like, for instance, the Foveon X3. But we have something more. I have shown it. We can easily obtain 4 or 5 or why not more color channels. And we will see in a while that we can obtain tunable spectral responses. And we have also some cons. For instance, we cannot use the standard 3 or 4 transistor active pixel electronics because we need to keep constant the voltage at the different contacts to keep constant the electric field. But so we need to integrate a different capacitance per color channel with, so that the charge is not integrated on the diode capacitor itself but on a different capacitance. And the pixel size, as a rule of thumb, cannot be shrinked below 2 or 2.5 microns because you have to keep a certain aspect ratio between the depth and the width of the device. And which is the concept? What is the concept of tunable spectral responses? Well, you have seen that we have some electric field streamlines representing the carrier collection trajectories. Well, these streamlines clearly depend on the set of biasing voltages that you are applying to the different contacts of the device. So if we change the applied voltages from V to V prime, so for instance, V sub 0 prime is different from V sub 0, you end up with a different electric field streamline configuration. And so just have a look at the difference between the top and bottom picture for contact number 0. You see that the contact is now collecting from a deeper depth and is collecting from an overall larger region. This turns out in an increase of the sensitivity of the blue contact and also in a shift of its peak, in this case towards the longer wavelength because it's collecting from a deeper region. And the same happens in this example for the green contact, while the red contact is now collecting fewer carriers, and so we have a decrease in its spectral response simply because the number of collected photocarriers is always the same. They are simply redistributed in a different way to the contacts. The same number of photocarriers is shared in a different way by the different contacts. So we can easily have, instantaneously have, because the voltage change is almost instantaneous, a device with tunable response spectra, so with a tunable color space, which is not determined a priori, as for instance in the case of color filter arrays or most of other color imaging devices. And here is what we did. What we first did is we realized the device can have a tunable spectral response. We measured the spectral response of the device in two different biasing conditions. We put this experimental spectral response inside the iSET software and simulated the acquisition chain, the acquisition chain of the image. So you can, for instance, use a certain set of voltages in which you can enhance the yellow and get a good yellow for this flower, and the yellow is almost close to the gamut of the selected display. Or you can decide to enhance the blue of this flower and changing the voltages, this point will be driven to an enhanced blue color. And this is done in this example for the whole sensor, so the changes for the whole, are the same for the whole pixels. But in principle, you can think to do these changes depending on the chroma of the different regions of the scene, so for clusters of pixel or in principle also at pixel level if you have a very increased hardware complexity, but in principle you can do that. Well, some experimental characterization. We were scared by the fact that the presence of several P+, N+, and shallow trenches on top of the device could generate a worsening in the dark current, so in the noise performances. So we tested some large passive pixels. These were strips with a 3.5 micron width and a 90 micron long. We compared these TFD devices with active TFD devices of these dimensions and compared both the measurements to an N+P standard photodiode. And I go fast through this slide because simply we observed no differences in the overall dark current with comparing the TFD, the two TFD structures with the test diode. So at least for the chosen technology, this seems not to be a problem. These are some other experimental characterization in terms of spectral responses. And this is more interesting. We obtained an overall good quantum yield around the 80% at the peak wavelength of 520 nanometers. Well, let's comment the shape of the spectral responses. The experimental ones are the bold ones. So you see that the blue spectral response is quite good, as effectively a peak in the blue region, and it's almost zero in the red region. But have a look at the red spectral response. We have a peak in the red region, but this response is still high in the blue region. This is simply determined by the fact that the pixel was wholly illuminated. So if you just remind the first slide, the red contact is collecting also carriers from lateral regions, from small depths, so it's also collecting blue photons. Well, this is not a problem if you consider an ideally noiseless detector. The Delta EAB that can be obtained, Delta EAB 2000 that can be obtained, is good, but this is only considering a noiseless detector. If you consider a noisy detector, well, the color conversion matrix has large negative coefficients ranging from minus 5 to minus 12, depending on the set of applied biasing voltages. And this turns out to be a source of noise propagation, and so it must be somewhat resolved. And the idea was to find a way to in which light can enter only the central region of the device, and these are simulation results for light entering only the central region. You see that the blue spectral response has almost the same shape, but the red spectral responses and the green spectral responses are quite improved. And the way we can do that, here we have the color conversion matrix for this last case compared to that of the foveon sensor presented in this reference. You see that now the numbers are quite similar. There are some ways to do this improvement. One way is to enlarge the inner region of the device with the drawback of having a larger overall pixel size. We can mask with metals in CMOS technology the lateral regions with another drawback, which is the loss in quantum yield. Probably the best way would be the use of micro lenses focusing on the central region of the device. Well, which is the status of the research about the TFD at the moment? The device was invented in 2008, and we spent some time on struggling the problem of isolation between the anodes, but we came to a solution, as I show it to you. In 2009, we had the first production of TFD chips, which was a sort of design for validation. The result that I showed you demonstrates the feasibility. It's a proof of concept. The working principle is good. In 2008, we also realized active TFD pixels, and we introduced the concept of tunable spectral responses, so of tunable color space. And we are now going to a phase in which we would like to exploit this concept of tunable color space, looking at what is enabled by the tunable color space. And so we are looking for a design targeted to specific applications. So we are going on with simulation and design of novel TFD chips targeted to specific applications. Which can be these applications? They can be divided roughly in two groups. The first one corresponds to work that we have already done, and in general, they relate to the adaptation of the TFD color space to the scene. We proposed an adaptation of the TFD spectral responses to the scene illuminant, for instance, making white balance by tunable spectral responses. As I showed in the slide of the flowers, one can think to an adaptation to the scene chromaticity, and we have also worked on the adaptation to the scene dynamic range by means of an interleaved imaging at full resolution obtained using the TFD. And the second group of applications is related to improving the image quality in terms of color accuracy. We will see the high color accuracy acquisition mode in the next slides, and we are also working on something like multispectral imaging and combined capture of RGB and near-infrared radiation using more than three channels and other applications I have not the time to talk about. Well, you know that typically we have a set of three filters, which is not a linear combination of the three stimulus. So the basic conversion technique is related to a reference chart, for instance, the magnet color checker or other checkers, illuminated by standard sources like the D65 or the D50 and so on. But ideally, one would like to mimic the three stimulus reference, so to obtain exactly these curves from the curve of his sensor. This is in practice never true because we, as I said, we have not a linear combination, but we can think to exploit redundancy, so using more than three spectral responses to try to better approximate these spectral responses, obtaining good results. And this is the principle which is beyond high color acquisition mode. The mathematical approach is very simple. These are our target function, x, y, z, and we have a certain number, n, of spectral responses. Well, if we take only one shot with the camera, we have three spectral responses, which are not a linear combination, so we cannot adopt this technique. But if we think, well, I take a shot, then I tune the spectral responses, I take another shot, then I tune the spectral responses, I take another shot, and for instance, for three shots, I end up with nine spectral responses. These are some results on tuning. You see, we have peak shifts, for instance. Here are simulation results. This green curve can be hardly seen, but it has a peak wavelength, which is almost 50 nanometers away from this other peak wavelength. And these are the experimental results obtained on the design at TFD. You see that the overall behavior is quite similar, except for the fact that, as I showed to you before, the basis of the red responses is not here zero, but is around 30 to 40%. So if we apply this technique using only one shot, the result is quite poor. We have, in no way we can approximate the tri-stimulus, but using two consecutive shots, we can obtain a better result, and using three consecutive shots, the result is quite good. It's clear that the larger is the number of consecutive shots, the better is the approximation, but one would like also to take a limited number of shots. This is an obvious constraint. So this is the results in terms of color reproduction error for the 24 patches of the Macular Color Checker. We compare the standard acquisition mode, so a single shot with a color conversion operated using the least mean square of the 24 patches of the Macular Color Checker, and we have an error, delta EAB error, for a noiseless detector, which is around 3.36. And these are experimental TFD curves. And we compare this with the proposed high color accuracy mode from the simulated TFD curve shown in the previous slide. Well, with three consecutive shots, so basically using these functions, we can end up with a very small delta EAB 2000 reconstruction error, which is lower than 0.8 for every color, almost every color except the blue in the Macular Color Checker. Here is a visual picture of the results. So, to conclude, the conclusion just repeats what I already said. What is important is that we have this concept. We have a detector with tunable spectral responses. I am an electronic engineer. I'm not a color scientist. So probably you have in mind many applications that can be enabled by a sensor with tunable spectral response that I have not in mind. So I hope you enjoyed this presentation, and I thank you for your attention.
Okay, it's your thing. You want to wait for the coffee break, so.
If you use a filter over the camera, the single camera, you can get very much closer to a linear combination of the color matching patches. Did you look at that?
I think that combining some filters on top of the camera may improve the.
Like if you use a purple filter of a certain spectrum.
A purple filter.
It increases the accuracy.
This is exactly an example that he's a color scientist and I'm an electronic engineer. So we can discuss it later.
Can you comment on the symmetry of the pixel and how, especially if you're using a micro lens and you have light coming in at different trajectories, if it's not perfectly symmetrical, you're going to get uniformity issues,
especially on the multicolor. Yeah, this basically depends on how you're good in aligning the micro lenses to your sensor. Basically, the device can reach a quite symmetric structure because if you do not use completely scaled design rules of the technology, you can design a very symmetric device, then the problem is the alignment of the microlens. This can be an issue, while, for instance, masking the lateral regions could be easier in this term.
Just, so this was a single pixel, or were there multiple pixels that you were considering?
The results were presented for a single passive pixel. The one that I said was 3.5 micron wide by 90 micron long, so a very long strip without integrated electronics. But we also tested active. We also designed and tested active pixels. So I think it was a 4x4 small mini matrix or something.
One thing you might want to consider is if you have multiple pixels in a 2x2 array, crosstalk issues.
And how Sorry, what would be?
Crosstalk issues.
The crosstalk.
If you have a 2x2 array.
Crosstalk between color channels, you mean? But as you can see, there's no crosstalk because here the carriers. I mean. The depletion region extends almost on the whole active layer. If you choose to a technology with, for instance, a 4 micron thick active layer, and then below you have a substrate which gives you no radiation, no problems. Well, this active layer is almost wholly depleted, so carriers are driven by the electric field, not by diffusion, so you do not have much crosstalk. But to be honest, I have never measured this crosstalk. So this is I've never measured this.
It's a very commendable paper. I had a question about your fill factor when you use just a central region. What kind of fill factor do you have for that?
These results were obtained simulating light impinging on the 40% of the area. So if you consider the field factor is, in this case, the 40%, but you have to take into account also the readout electronics. This is only right. the field factor of the passive pixel. But if you consider devices with CFA, there you have a loss of almost a 66% of the radiation because of the filter. So that's not so bad.
Well, I was concerned also from the basis of aliasing, too, as well.
Sorry?
Aliasing. Yes, you have a small fill factor, you get more aliasing. But no, that's great. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay.